Good morning.
Good morning.
This is Russ and Kitty Walden with Father's Heart Ministry and our daughter Jennifer, and this is the Morning Light Daily Bible Study, where we go through the Bible chapter by chapter and give you your whole Bible back. And in the last several weeks, about the last 2 weeks, we've been looking at and studying the book of Ecclesiastes. You've been getting Ecclesiastes back, which some people think that's kind of a mixed blessing because there is a consensus among theologians and teachers that the book of Ecclesiastes is an inspired record of the uninspired sayings of Solomon. And I differ with that because 30 times in the book of Ecclesiastes, it says that his perspective is that which is under the sun. In other words, excluding eternal values, he's saying all is vanity, vanity, vexation of spirit, which is what the Apostle Paul said. If we in this life only have hope, we're of all men most miserable. I'll never forget, as a young pastor, the Lord began to talk to me about messages I was bringing in the church. He said, you're just speaking about lateral issues, issues of Christian faith as respects the subject of the family, getting along in life, vocation, dealing with past, present, and future circumstances and situations in everyday living. And he said, if that's all you ever do, you're never going to see people be lifted up out of the misery of mundane existence. We don't hear a lot of teaching about heaven. We hear very little teaching about eternity. We hear that when we go to a funeral, when we go to a graveside service. Then there's a few little obligatory remarks that get made about the fact that this life is not the end, there's eternity in view. But in the scriptures, the long view is ever present in almost every passage of scripture that you spend any time looking at. We're always being pointed to eternity. And here in chapter 12, Solomon is, he's summing up. It's his wrapping up what he's writing about in the book of Ecclesiastes, absent from the body, present with the Lord. In this concluding chapter today, we find a profound truth about mortality, eternity, and oneness with the Father. It's one of my favorite, and here we go again, one of my favorite passages and a subject that I really enjoy looking into as Solomon seeks to pull back the curtain of natural understanding and even theological understanding about what happens after death, even what death is and what constitutes life. And from a mystical standpoint, there is a point, even in unregenerate man, that their human spirit or the life principle that God gave them when they were born will return, according to Solomon in this chapter, to God that gave it, even if they're not born again. Because Solomon is talking here about all mankind, and he discusses in this chapter about the spirit going back to God that gave it when the man dies. And he doesn't pause to say, that is, if you have been born again according to an evangelical formula for accepting Jesus Christ as your Savior. Now, listen to what I'm saying, what I'm not saying. I can make a remark like that, and you would think perhaps I've strayed from orthodoxy in terms of the necessity of salvation. I am not saying that everybody goes to heaven. But there is a point in even in an unregenerate man, that when they die, according to Solomon, their human spirit will return to God. The question is, for every man and woman, have they accepted the sacrifice of the cross so that when God does take the breath of life back to himself, we'll find the open door of access available to us to be absent from our body, to be present with the Lord. Now, evangelical thinking on this subject is cloudy in some respects from the perspective of Solomon's insights. And so Solomon's trying to help us better understand. You have to delve into the mystical at a certain point to understand things about eternity. You say, well, how can you go back to God at the end of your life if every man goes back to God according to how we're going to look in this chapter, the statements that are made, then you are saying that everybody goes to heaven. Well, what is hell? Hell is a place of fire. And now think about that. An unregenerate man, God is a consuming fire. He's a fire from his loins up and from his loins down. And we pray constantly for the fire of God, don't we? Man, if you as a born-again person, if you were invited, how would you like to experience the fire of God? Yes, absolutely. Let me have it. Let me have it right now. Because we just instinctively, because we're born again, we trust God, we have faith in God. Well, what if you took an unregenerate man? What if you took a character like Adolf Hitler and you plucked him up out of his mortality and put him in the center of where God was? God is still a consuming fire, and he wouldn't like it there very much. In fact, he might even describe that as hell. Now, again, listen to what I'm saying, what I'm not saying. These are just things that make me question, things that I ponder. We have so much simplistic theology about these things that we never stop to really look at the scope of the remarks and teachings that we see in various scriptures, including Ecclesiastes, and when they stray from the simplistic explanations of evangelical theology, well, we conclude like theologians do. Well, it's just an uninspired viewpoint. Solomon wasn't really. I don't buy that. And I don't accept that. It's very convenient for us to, we do that in various scriptures. Many of the writings of Paul will say, well, he was writing to a first century culture barely out of the Bronze Age. And that was, no, this is the eternal truth. And it's applicable to us today just as it was millennia ago. And so we're going to begin, and just hang with me. We're going to just study some things. Quite frankly, these things don't disturb me. These things delight me. It opens to me the mysteries of God. And I delight to look into things that I don't feel like I have to fully comprehend them to admire and be in awe of the truth of God and the truth of his word. I don't have to reconcile what I read in the Bible to evangelical theology or orthodoxy in order to feel like I am properly appreciating the scripture. The scripture is not set to find its validity in reconciling itself to evangelical theology. Evangelical theology should find its validity by comparing itself to the scripture. Do you see what I'm saying? Which one is the authority? So we'll begin in our concluding study of Ecclesiastes chapter 12 with verses 1 through 6, please.
Okay. Remember now thy Creator in the days of thy youth, while the evil days come not, nor the years draw nigh, when thou shalt say, I have no pleasure in them, while the sun or the light or the moon or the stars be not darkened, nor the clouds return after the rain. In the day when the keepers of the house shall tremble, and the strong men shall bow themselves, and the grinders cease from, because they are few, and those that look out of the windows be darkened, and the doors shall be shut in the streets, when the sound of the grinding is low, and he shall rise up at the voice of the bird, and all the daughters of music shall be brought low. Also when they shall be afraid of that which is high, and fears shall be in the way, and the almond tree shall flourish, and the grasshopper shall be a burden, and desire shall fail, because men goeth to his long home, and the mourners go about the streets. Or ever the silver cord be loosed, or the golden bowl be broken, or the pitcher be broken at the fountain, or the wheel be broken at the cistern.
Now look what he's saying there in verse 6. Now this is just one sentence that's describing in mystical language what happens when a man dies. It says, ever the silver cord be loosed, and the golden bowl be broken, or the pitcher broken at the fountain, or the wheel at the cistern. Now, what wheel are we talking about? Now, if you study this, you will find many people look at the things mentioned in verse 6, speaking of the physical anatomy. It talks about in the earlier verse about the grinders are grinding low, and they say he's talking about the teeth of old people, that they get to where they don't make as much sound because they're just gumming their food instead of actually chewing it with teeth and all of this. But what I go to when I see the wheel being broken at the cistern, I go to the book of James, where James talks about the wheel of nature that is controlled by the tongue, by what comes out of your mouth.
Right.
And the power of your words. He's talking about something much deeper than these surface observations that we could make. And chapter 12 of Ecclesiastes is one that I've looked forward to presenting for its subject matter and its beauty, its mysticism. Solomon here is concluding his sum of human life, and he directs our minds to the weightier matters of eternal importance. Under the sun, there is vanity, vanity, and vexation of spirit. But once we choose to look to God and seek first the kingdom, then life finds its meaning, and the soul finds its rest. Verse 1 begins with an exhortation to remember your Creator in the days of your youth. You know, there's a maturity that is denied to young people that will evidence itself by the wisdom gained once decades of life have passed into personal history. I know my father got a lot smarter the older I got. I understood him a lot more. I deeply disagreed with him in many areas when I was a young man in my 20s and in my 30s, but then moving into my 40s and into my 50s, I've had many conversations with my eldest brother, and we'd talk about our father's perspective on things, and we'd chuckle and we'd say, yep, Dad's just getting smarter all the time, isn't he? When in reality, it was just us gaining the perspective that only some things you don't learn until you watch processes that take place over decades. And particularly in the law of sowing and reaping, because a young man you might see be in a conflict and say, how could God let that person get away with that? But you watch that situation over the course of decades, and you will see God always rights the scales. I've had many personal struggles in my early adulthood dealing with contradictions to God's promise in my life that were resolved as time passed. I learned that God works from a broader perspective than my patience would allow. Perfect example of that is Jesus said, behold, I come quickly, and it's been 2,000 years. God works from a time frame different from ours. Many times I've lamented at broken relationships and misunderstandings whose scales were balanced over time, whereby I couldn't learn the deeper lesson until years had gone by. So Solomon's lesson, it's interesting what he says. He says, remember your Creator. His lesson in Ecclesiastes is not remember your mortality. His lesson is remember your Creator. Do you see how that pulls us out of an earthly perspective to looking at life with eternity in view? See, your mortality, is a matter of perspective. This life is but a vapor. And sooner or later, life, short of putting on immortality, walking into our immortality, or the rapture of the church, or whatever, however you want to define those events, sooner or later, this life will exhaust itself. And we will meet our end. If all of hope and happiness is only to be found in the few short years we enjoy on earth, then there is no point to existence. We'll be like the Epicureans philosophers that the gladiators in ancient Rome subscribed to. Let's just eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. But we know that there is more to life than that. See, the fact of the matter is, however, that you are an eternal being experiencing a temporal season of mortality. Let me say that to you again. You are an eternal being experiencing a temporal season of mortality. Ephesians says you were holy and without blame before God in love before the foundation of the world. Job said that the sons of God, of which you are one, sang for joy before the founding of the world. Say, well, how come I don't remember it? Because you were out of your mind. That's why. Right. Because the mind is a function of the soul, and you didn't have a soul until you were brought into the earth. Adam did not have a soul until God put his breath in that body that he made him. The soul is evidenced when body and spirit come together. Soul is manifested. Soul was not, and this gets into some of the things I like to look at in this chapter, soul was not directly created by God. Soul was what was produced when God put his spirit into that physical body that he made for Adam. So the spirit of God and the physical body of Adam came together and a living soul was produced. We're going to get deeper into that in just a little bit. So Solomon states that while the sun and moon endure, nevertheless, even strong men bow themselves in old age. And though many doors may be opened in the city during the day, they are closed at night, which is a reference to the reality of our own brevity and our own mortality. He talks about the almond tree budding, which speaks of when the blossoms turn pink, from pink to white, even as the hairs of your head turn to snow as you get older, unless you're like me and, you know, your hair doesn't turn gray, it just lets go.
Goes away.
And desires and appetites are diminished as we make our way from this transient sojourn to our, what Solomon calls our long home. Man goes to his long home in eternity. Solomon then looks beyond the natural perspective, and he gives this mystical description of the end of life, described as a silver cord that is loosed and a pitcher broken, and the wheel at a cistern is broken. Some suggest that the cord, the bowl, and the pitcher speak of the spinal cord, the brain, and the heart that wind down in advanced old age and eventually cease to function. I think that it goes much deeper than that. I wouldn't exclude that, but it's much deeper than that. This may certainly be true, that the body does wind down, but that viewpoint does not exclude the deeper mystical meaning that we can only hint at, pondering at the enormity of the reality of death and the eventuality of our exit from mortality into an eternal state under one set of judgments or the other. When I look at this chapter, it's like peering. It's probably the most transparent view we have of our own mortality from a spiritual perspective. And you look at this and it's like, I know I'm seeing something, but I'm not sure what I'm looking at. And I can just stand and just gaze at what this chapter shows us and just ponder it for a long time. There's true deeps here for you and I to divine, and we may not come away with a comprehension, but we can come away with an understanding that there's more to this life than what we're experiencing. And so verse 7 through the end of the chapter.
Then shall the dust return to the earth as it was, and the spirit shall return unto God who gave it. Vanity of vanities, saith the preacher, all is vanity. And moreover, because the preacher was wise, he still taught the people knowledge. Yea, he gave good heed and sought out and set in order many proverbs. The preacher sought out to find out acceptable words, and that which was written was upright, even words of truth. The words of the wise are as goads and as nails fastened by the masters of assemblies, which are given from one shepherd. And further by these, my son, be admonished, of making many books there is no end, and much study is weariness of the flesh. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil.
So what's the end of the matter? Fear God, keep his commandments. So many times people come to us for prophetic ministry, and the synthesis of what is often repeated over and over again is Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom, all things will be added. Mm-hmm. 90% of the requests that we get are all wrapped up in people wanting to know about all the things. When are all these things? I'm having trouble with things. I want things. And there's nothing wrong with that. Because God gives things, but there is a path by which, what is it that's lacking in your life? I don't care what it is. We got all wrapped up in how complex and convoluted and difficult we could ever imagine our life being different from what it is. See, that's where hopelessness comes from. It's rooted in pride. Now, let me say something to you. Hopelessness is rooted in pride because we feel as though we cannot conceive of a process by which our life could be different than we're now experiencing it. Rather than consigning ourselves to the simplicity of the fact that the scripture cannot be broken, and that if you define what seek first the kingdom looks like in your life on a daily basis and give yourself over to it, then God is not a liar. All things. What are the things? All things that are lacking. What's lacking in your life? What's broken in your life? What's fractured in your life? All things will be added. If that is not true, then God's a liar, and we can all just deposit our Bibles at the dumpster on the way out the door because we're kidding ourselves. The simplicity of the truth of the truth of God. Now, in verse 7, we see that our body is formed of dust and will now return to the earth from whence it came. Now, remember, this was not in the original plan of God. You remember when we studied in Genesis that there was not one man that lived 1,000 years? Mm-hmm. Even Methuselah died at the age of 964. Mm-hmm. God told Adam, if you eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and people are still eating that fruit today, that many people have a lovely fruit basket that they partake of every single day of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And he said, if you eat of that tree, in the day that you eat of that tree, you will die. And Peter said, a day with the Lord is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as a day. And Adam died in the day that he ate of the tree. But yet, isn't it interesting that Enoch, does that mean if Adam hadn't have eaten of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, that we might run into him down at the Bob Evans Cafe here in Branson one day because there'd be no sin and he'd still be running around? I don't think so. I think Enoch demonstrated what God had in mind for man, that man would live out his day, a 1,000-year day, and then he'd just walk with God and be not, for God would take him. Because resurrection, ascension, transfiguration is a part of God's of how God presents himself to us in terms of his plan. And we don't have to have a sin nature to see the necessity of an ascension. So I believe that if man had not sinned and Adam had lived out a sinless existence, there would have just been a point in time after 1,000 years, he'd fulfilled all his assignments and he'd just look to the Lord and be dismissed. And so it was never God's intention that that body go back to dust. But yet Solomon points it out in verse 7 that it does. The body formed of dust will now return to the earth from whence it came. It was not in the original plan of God, but it is a consequence of the fall and man's disobedience. When God told Adam and Eve in Genesis 3:19, he said, in the sweat of your face you shall eat bread till you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken, for dust you are, and dust you shall return, because of the fall, because of sin. Then verse 7 makes a statement. Now listen to what it says. It makes a statement in Genesis 2:7. We're going to be quoting this. that bears deeper consideration. Let's read it. It says, then shall dust return to the earth as it was, and the spirit, Ecclesiastes 12:7. Now listen to this. And the spirit shall return unto God that gave it.
Amen.
If you're born again, if you're a member of a good Bible preaching evangelical church, if you've signed a decision card, if you were mm-hmm. baptized, mm-hmm. it doesn't say any of that. In fact, he's writing to a people, to a generation to whom the new birth experience was not available.
Mm-hmm.
And evangelical thinking says that in your spirit, you are a child of Satan until you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior and you become born again. If that's true, then why is God taking a child of Satan, that human spirit, back to him when a man dies? Because this isn't talking about the righteous dead. This is talking about a universal experience of when a man dies, whatever constitutes his human spirit is going to go back to God like it was on loan from God.
David. Amen.
God breathed into man of his spirit, and then when a man dies, he takes that back to himself. And I don't care whether you're an evangelical or not. Now again, listen to what I'm saying, what I'm not saying. Well, you're saying that everybody, it's universalism, everybody's going to heaven. That is not what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
And you need to listen to me, because I think it's important for us to get what the scripture's telling us. Now let's go and look at Genesis 2:7. Let's understand something about where man's human spirit came from. Genesis 2:7 says that God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And that word breath is ruach. It's the Hebrew word for spirit and the Hebrew word for wind. So God breathed in, and God didn't have to breathe into man. He didn't breathe into the animals. He didn't breathe into creation. He could have just snapped his fingers and man would have come to life. But he didn't do that. He breathed into man, something of himself. And notice what it says. And then man became something. He became a living soul. What that tells you is God did not directly create the soul. He made a body. He breathed into that body. And man became something as a secondary effect of God putting something of himself in that piece of dust. I used to tell my kids, I don't know whether I should regret it or not, but it was a funny thing. I'd talk theology to my 4 and 5 year old kids, and I'd read that verse that, you know, you come from the dust. And I'd say, you know what that means? I'd say, no, what does that mean, Daddy? I says, you ain't nothing but dirt. And they'd look at me and they say, that's not true. They knew they were more than that instinctively. So you can see that God made man's body, and just go with me now. God made man's body and then breathed something of himself into that lifeless form. Something of himself that the scripture calls the breath of life. And the method of delivery was described as God breathing into man. In other words, God constituted man's life, the life principle in man, from the constituent components of something of his uncreated being that was on the inside of him. He took something that was in him and he breathed it into man. This is what man's human spirit is made of. The ruach, or the spirit of God. That's why David, when he talked about, I was born in sin and shapen in iniquity, that the word shapen means imprisoned. In other words, and that's why Jesus told an inveterate, unregenerate generation, he wasn't talking to evangelicals, he was talking to the men who were going to crucify him. He said, the kingdom of God is in you. It's in you. And they weren't even born again.
That's right.
And when he said they're going to say, look here or look there, he says, don't look at that. Whatever the kingdom of God is, it's on the inside of you. So, the Spirit of God breathed into man in the beginning and passed on to every man and woman created on the earth. When a man dies, then Ecclesiastes 12:7 says that God takes this back. Whatever this is, he takes it back to himself. Does that mean everybody goes to heaven? That's not what it's saying. Solomon's description of the body returning to dust and the human spirit made up of God's uncreated spirit returns back then to God that gave it. Thus, we learn something of the nature of man's spirit and what your human spirit really is in contrast to the soul. Again, remember, now you're saying we are God, aren't you, Brother Walden? If you're really listening, you might think that's what I'm saying, but that's not what I'm saying. Job 27:3 makes an identification between the life principle that is in you and the Spirit of God itself. In other words, what God put in man was not like some sort of ethereal electricity that made him come to life. The Bible plainly identifies what it was that... Why do you think scientists cannot create life? Now, they claim they can. They'll clone a sheep, and they can clone human beings. But you know what they can't do? They can't take something that is dead and bring it to life. They can't take something that does not have life. They can manipulate life, but they cannot originate life.
That's right.
Why? Listen to Job 27:3. It says, Job was talking about his own vital principle. And he says, as all the while that my breath is in me. Now, this is the breath of life that God breathed into Adam. Now Job's talking about that, which has been passed down to him. He said, while my breath is in me, the Spirit of God in my nostrils. So he equates the vital principle of life on the inside of you, rooted in your human spirit, and the Spirit of God to be one and the same. So God created your life, your created life, is made up of the uncreated life of God.
Amen.
An extension of something of himself that he put on the inside of every man and woman, whether they're born again or not.
True.
Are you listening to me?
He said we are all God's creation in Acts.
That's why he said in the beginning of Ecclesiastes, he says God has set eternity in the hearts of man that they might seek after him.
Amen. His DNA.
See, where do you think Jesus got this stuff? I see so many of the deepest sayings of Jesus originating in the book of Ecclesiastes. But yet theologians that claim to be the authority about the teachings of Jesus reject the book of Ecclesiastes in terms of its content. So what of the soul? Genesis 2:7, you will see that God did not directly create the soul. The soul, again, sprang into being when God put something of himself, his breath, into man's body. God breathed into man, and he became a living soul. God breathed his spirit into man, and soul came into existence because of the union of God's breath, or spirit, and man's body. Now, this is very interesting because the soul is where almost the totality of the average person's understanding of who he is resides. But you are so much more than that. Your mind, your will, your emotions, your memory. I made the statement a minute ago. The Bible teaches that you were with God before the foundation of the world. And I asked the Lord, how come I don't remember it? He says, because you were out of your mind. Because you didn't have a soul. Your human spirit did not have a memory. The reason why, it doesn't need a memory. When you're in eternity where everything is now, what do you need a memory for? Memory is a function of fallen man. The past, present, future perspective is a function of fallen man's perceptions. That's why you didn't need a mind or a memory when you were with God in eternity before the foundation of the world was laid. And that's why you have to access your spiritual data banks, if I can use that term, in order to grasp that information. The Bible talks about the mind of the spirit and the mind of the flesh. The mind of the spirit doesn't have a memory because it knows everything and it experiences everything at the same time, just like God does. So it's interesting. See, in this transitory being whose existence is the result of something eternal of God's breath entering into your lifeless physical form that God created from the dust of the earth. Now let's go back and talk about death. When someone dies, even if they're not born again, their spirit goes back to God that gave it. Why? Because their spirit is an extension of the uncreated life of God that God breathed into Adam and has been reproduced in every generation of man right down to when you came out of your mama's belly. It's something of God's, the Bible says plainly, God gives to man his breath. And if you study the language, it's not like he just gives you the process of breathing and then he goes on to do more important things. No, the understanding is that God, by an act of his will, gives you every moment of your existence.
Every single breath.
The soul only exists, your mind, will, and emotion only exist because of the union of the breath of God, man's human spirit, with the body. When the body dies, the spirit departs. The body goes back to dust, and the spirit of man, the breath of God within him, the vital principle that makes man's heart beat and his brain to think, goes back to God. What of the soul? You got to remember that the soul came into existence because of its proximity to something that is eternal. And what it was in proximity to, it took on the nature of. But yet if that soul rebels against God, then it has existence outside of God. And God takes back that portion of himself that made you walk around in an animate life, and then you find yourself outside of fellowship with God at the end of your lifespan. See, what of your soul? What of your self-consciousness? The very word self may say, well, my self-consciousness resides in my spirit. No, it doesn't. The very word self comes from the Greek word psuche, which means soul. It's not your spirit. People say, I am a spirit, I have a soul, I live in a body. Well, that's true if you are in fact a spirit. But there's a whole lot of soulish Christians going around saying, I am a spirit. And it's like, I think it was Peter talked about, the abomination of desolation sitting in the temple where it ought not, declaring itself to be God.
Whoa.
You teach that as a doctrine, and you're putting Christians in a very bad position because you're teaching them to anoint their soul as though it was God himself, mm-hmm. when they're very soulish. And we know they're soulish because they say, I think, I feel, I will. Their identity is rooted in the soul. And they can't see past the soul. Jesus never spoke of his soul in that manner.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus always talked of his soul in the third person, just like we talk about our bodies. And look, I cut my finger. We don't say, I am cut. We say, I cut my finger. We realize that our body is the house of the mind, will, and emotions. And we understand our body somehow is external to who we are. But Jesus wore his soul the way you and I wear our bodies. And then he made the statement. He said, I and my Father are one, and my Father is a spirit. Why? Because his sense of his sentience, if you will, his awareness of his own existence was rooted and grounded in his human spirit, not in his soul man. See?
Is that why you said, now my soul is exceedingly sorrowful?
That's what he said. We would say, now I am sorrowful. Jesus said, now my soul is sorrowful, exceedingly nigh unto death.
So he didn't claim it.
He said, it's not me. He said, it's my soul man.
I like that. That's good.
There's some deep truth here, folks.
Yummy.
And the question is, if you're all wrapped up in a soul existence and your spirit goes back to God that gave it, you better hope you have a kite string tied to your toe. And that it's going to go with it. To see the maturity and the experience of what the new birth is really intended to produce is to open a door so that your identity, your sense of self, moves out of the soul and into the spirit, and you become God-conscious more than you are self-conscious, which is why Adam and Eve didn't know they were naked till after they sinned. When they sinned, self-consciousness eclipsed God-consciousness. Before that, all they knew was God.
Was on. Mm-hmm.
And the Lord wants to bring us back to that. That's what the new birth is all about.
Amen.
So.
That's really good.
Jesus, again, he says that the Father is a spirit and that he himself was one with the Father. In other words, the seat of Jesus' consciousness, because he was sinless, was in his spirit and not in his soul. That is why he always refers to his soul in the third person. When we speak of mind, will, and emotion, we almost always refer to it directly as I think, I feel, I will. The philosophers say, ergo cogito sum, I think, therefore I am. Yeah. Well, we know that's not true. What about people that that do not have the ability to think? What about people that are disabled in that way? Does that mean they don't exist? Does that mean they don't have an eternal nature? Because they don't have the ability to cognate as others do? See, Jesus understood his soul to be something external to himself, to his true sentience. At his core, Jesus was one with the Father, and when he went to the cross to make a way for us to transmigrate the ground of the soul and to become as we were created, to be one with the Father as he was one with the Father. I and my Father are one. And I go, that's why he told Peter. Peter said, I'm going to die for you. He says, no, you won't. You're going to deny me three times. But then the chapter breaks, but he goes on to say, in John 13, he said, but let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. I go to prepare a place for you that where I am, not where I was, not where I will be. He's not talking about building a log cabin in the corner of glory land.
Amen.
He said, in my Father's house are many mansions, but the wording there is abiding places. And I'm going to go prepare a place for you that where I am, you may be also. Where was he? He was one with the Father.
Abiding in him.
He was abiding in the Father. The Father was one with him. He was one with the Father. And he had the grace to lay his life down and to take it up again and to go down into hell with the keys of death, hell, and the grave and plunder the enemy's captivity. Where do you think that authority comes from? This is the transaction. We're waiting for some magical dollop of Holy Ghost whipped cream to give us all authority. But you need to understand that that kind of authority proceeds out of a maturing process by which the housing of the soul is no longer fit for who you are. And you must move in to that spiritual identity of becoming one with the Father that you can say to others, have I been so long with you that you have not known me, Philip?
My Jesus.
That's and awesome. I haven't apprehended, but that doesn't mean I can't preach it and point to it as a truth for you and I. A holy, godly ambition for each one of us.
We're pressing into. Amen. That's powerful, hon. I think it's not taught enough.
It's never taught. Nobody right. teaches this stuff.
Yeah, to become so God conscious that you really don't need to be hanging out on the earth anymore. You get that. You said in your book, if you want what Enoch had and that's go right. where Enoch went, you got to do what he did.
That's what Enoch in Walks with God is all about.
He hung out with the Father until he became one with him.
When someone dies who does not know Jesus as Savior, their spirit, the spirit even of that person, goes back to God. But the sentience, the self-consciousness and awareness of that person is excluded. And the deeper truth, and I will say maybe, that it's not excluded, but when they are immersed in the God who is a consuming fire, that's hell for them.
That's right. That's right.
Now, we just walk very tenderly there. And I'm not establishing doctrine. That's right. I'm just giving you something to think about. So when we have accepted the blood sacrifice of Christ, what does the Bible teach us? The middle wall of partition. What middle wall of partition? That gulf that Lazarus mm-hmm. and the rich man talked about between the spirit and the soul that is now bridged by the shed blood of Calvary, and the veil of the defiled conscience is rent, and we can come with simplicity and purity into the very heart of the presence of God that is much more something on the inside of you than it is some Greek idea of a planet somewhere called heaven.
That's right.
And I'm not saying that you're not going to heaven. And I'm not trying to take your wedding feast and your
mansion,
little cabin in the corner of glory land. I preached this years ago and somebody went off on me. You're not going to take my cabin in the corner of glory land. I'm going to have my cabin.
Okay.
Heaven help us.
abiding places, though. That's where he is now, with a father always at one with him.
So the middle wall of partition is broken down between the soul and the spirit, and it becomes possible for us to become one with the Father, but it still required a process for you and I. Then when we die, the spirit likewise takes its flight, but in this case, we are one in the spirit that Job says in reality is the extension of God's uncreated life, constituted our mortality, and now we're returning to God for eternity. Returning to God with the talent. What do you think the talent is? It's not a piece of money. Mm-hmm. What have you done with the talent of the extension of his uncreated life in you that makes your heart beat and your lungs breathe and your mind to think? And what are you going to? How are you going to present the stewardship of that when you stand before God? The lesson for us is that even a person not born again is breathing and walking around because God's spirit constitutes his mortality. Paul points this out. Now, and again, here's one of those passages in Acts 17, 27 through 29, that if you talk to a theologian or someone who has studied deeply the orthodox way of looking at these verses, they will say that Paul got this wrong. And I've heard learned theologians say that what Paul said here was completely wrong. It was an absolute failure. It didn't produce anything. And he was in error because it doesn't agree with evangelical thought. Listen to what he says. Paul is declaring the unknown God to all the pagans on Mars Hill. Wasn't a single one of them born again.
Right.
And notice what he says to him. He tells them, look, he was describing them as those that were seeking the Lord, if haply they might feel after him and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. Well, how far is he? Jesus said he's on the inside of you.
Close as your breath.
As close as the breath of your nostrils. He's on the inside of you. Jesus said, whatever the kingdom of God is, they wanted to know about God's linear purpose through time. When will you restore the kingdom into Israel? He says, the kingdom that you're looking for is not something that's unveiled as a linear process through time. You could forget your Clarence Larkin charts. You could forget all of this stuff that sees it as some sort of a timeline that we have to attach ourselves to. As far as Jesus was concerned, whatever the kingdom was something that was on the inside of those people he was talking to, and they were about to bring out the nail and the hammer and the wood and crucify him. He said, what you're looking for is on the inside of you. And then he went on to double down on the point. He said, when they try to get you to look here, or they try to get you to look there for the Christ, don't follow after that, because whatever my kingdom is, it's on the inside of you. And so he goes on, he says that they should seek the Lord, if haply they might feel after him, as though he be not far from every one of us. Verse 28. Now listen to what he says. He's talking to pagans. For in him we live and move and have our being. In other words, our existence moment by moment. Quantum theorists tell us that we're actually blinking in and out in a frequency of reality like a radio wave. And they cannot account for where we go when we blink out of existence and what brings us back. Mm-hmm. And quantum theorists have to start talking theology, and they hate that because they're primarily mostly atheists. Mm-hmm. And they say, this gets over into the realm of theology, let's stop talking about it. Mm-hmm. They absolutely get projectile vomiting when you start talking about the God particle.
My mind.
For in him we live and move and have our being, as certain of your own poets have said, for we, talking to the pagans, are also his offspring. Whatever we are, we have sprung out of the fact that God breathed his uncreated, extended life into that physical body, and we became what we are. So we ought not to think that the Godhead is likened to gold, silver, or stone graven by art, man's artifice. Oh, yeah, we don't worship stones or rocks. Oh, we don't. The scripture says that the love of money is the root of all evil. And another rendering of that is the desire to shine. How many of us, when we go out and we get in our nice new car, why? Because we want to shine. We dress ourselves in certain ways, and we handle ourselves in certain ways. We want to have an eternal youthfulness. Why? Because of a desire to shine. It's a whole lot more than money. Because we're wanting something that is externally evident because we have no concept of the inward glory that God has put on the inside of every one of us. That Jesus died to remove the callus of sin and rend that thing open, that the God who breathed into us, we might once again become one with him and have relationship with him. Have you ever heard it like that before? Let me tell you, I preach this. I've talked to atheists and intellectuals who've never believed in God. Now say, you know that field of all possibility that you believe that all creation sprang out of? I believe the same thing. I just have found evidence in myself that that is not only a field of all possibility from which all creation springs, from which the Big Bang manifested, but I have found that that field is imbued with a personality that sent his son to die and bleed, that you and I might not only be a product of that field, but we might enter into that field and find an eternal fellowship with him beyond any realm or understanding of existences that we might imagine. That cannot be embraced empirically. It can only be embraced mystically. See, this is why Jesus said, now think about it. If in him we live and move and have our being, that's why Jesus said, as much as you've done it unto the least of these, you've done it unto me. Because when you abuse, when you misuse, when you mistreat others, when you separate yourself from others, you've separated yourself from the God that's in them. See, the whole nature of love is a whole lot more than an emotional thing. I choose to love you. Love is a recognition of who and what your fellow man really is on the inside of him. And because you honor the God that created us, you would not dare deny. Because to deny that man, that woman, is to deny the God that's on the inside of him. And Jesus says, you deny them, you deny me, because I'm on the inside of them, making them breathe, their heartbeat, and their brains to think just like I do you. See, at that depth, God is inside every man, although every man is not inside of God. God gives, in fact. God is the breath of every man, but every man is not one with God unless they've accepted the reality of the shed blood of Calvary, by which our soul then is free to become one with the Father, at which time it is possible that when we die and our spirit returns to God, that we are thus attached and one with our spirit, in our sentience, our self-awareness, and therefore eligible to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord.
My goodness, that's powerful, hon.
I've just never heard it taught like that.
I've heard.
But is it not the plain truth of Scripture?
It's absolutely there in black and white. You just have to want it bad enough to dig for it. And I've heard you talk about those things before, but it just, every time I hear it, the reality of it is, you know, our spirit is supposed to be stronger on the inside of us. And that's why I think, I was just rereading Jude 20, but ye beloved, building up yourselves in your on your most holy faith by praying in the Holy Ghost. I think that's the only way as a believer you can master, you can conquer. Because you can be the master of your mind by the Spirit of God. You can be the master of your flesh only by the Spirit of God. So praying in the Holy Ghost takes on a whole new meaning for those who have been filled with the Spirit and speak with other tongues. And if your friends and family don't, you need to introduce them to the power tool that the Holy Spirit is.
And just like Psalms follows Job, and you just get the sense that the order of the Scriptures is ordained of God, because you get all this scorn and mockery in Job, and you come into Psalm 1, he says, don't sit in the seat of the mocker, don't... in other words, he says, you see all that garbage you just spent 41 chapters studying? Don't be like that. Mm-hmm. And now we see this great truth presented in Ecclesiastes, and the very next verse, and the first verse of Song of Solomon we'll look at tomorrow, is, let him kiss me with the kisses of his lips, for his love is better than wine. That's Let's right. have him, shall we?
Yes, let's have him. Father, thank you for these big truths in your word. They're all as important as the first verse in Genesis, and they'll be important when we sign off in Revelation and then maybe begin again. God, you are so good to tell us the truth and remind us of who we really are. Thank you for helping us to see the light of your word and then to walk in that light and help others come into the light of your countenance so they too can have a life worth living. In Jesus' name, amen.